Good morning again. It's good to see everybody here today. Today we are praying for the Sutradhar of India and their Bengali speaking people, and they're located primarily in West Bengali, which is in the eastern portion of India between the Himalaya Mountains and the Bay of Bengali. Their population is around 859,000, and many of them are involved in woodworking as a trade. Like most people in India, they are primarily into Hinduism, and they worship idols made by human hands. The Bible and evangelical efforts are available in the heart of the language of the Sutradhar, yet very few of these people are believers. So we just need to pray that God will open doors. So let's pray. Hey, Father, thank you so much for this day that you've given to us an opportunity to come and worship you. And we just want to lift up these folks, the Sutradhar of India. We pray that you will send workers into their area, that your word would penetrate their hearts, that they would be introduced to the good news of your gospel, so that many of these people would come to know you as Lord and Savior and proclaim you as the Lord of their life. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen.
Are you blessed?
Yes.
Really? You blessed? Are you blessed?
Yes.
Then let's sing about it. Count your many blessings.
When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one.
Count your many blessings, see what God hath done.
Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does the cross seem heavy you are called to bear? Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. See what God has done. So amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend, help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done.
Okay, old timers, who do you think of when we sing that? Cliff, he loved that guitar. Jesus, only a pastor would say that. Children, you are dismissed to go downstairs to pack. Now we got the big children up here. God's good, right? All the time?
God is good.
He's a good, good father, isn't he?
Stories of what they take your life, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're good, good Father. Undeniable.
my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me.
While I lay down, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after.
Experience. Literally, I didn't know that was going to happen. Thank you for those of you who jumped in right away to help, and for those of you who got out of the way to pray. We appreciate it. This is really the first time it's ever happened that I've been pastor. There was a time in Michigan where the pastor looked out there and said, I think we need some help in the foyer. And all of the police officers in our church, we had like two detectives from the Flint Police Department and two other police officers jumped up to go out there. And the pastor said, no, medical personnel. So they went out. So let's pray. Father God, we do pray right now for Bill. Lord, we don't ever expect that, but Lord, when something like this happens, I thank you for people that have been trained and know what to do in this situation and to help. And Father, I just pray now that God, you would be with him, encourage him, strengthen his heart, his body. Lord, we know that you are a great healer. You are the great physician, but your plans are always perfect. And so, Father, we thank you for that. We pray for Laura and Tommy through this, Lord, that you would encourage them as well. Lord, I just pray that you would use your word to lift them up and remind them of your great love. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your grace. And now, Lord, just encourage us as we look into your word. And Lord, we thank you for this. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm going to keep going. If you don't feel comfortable and you want to leave, we understand. But we're going to keep going with the service. God's word needs to be preached. Yes. Amen. Amen. Yeah. Amen. And that kind of goes along with the theme of today. So I'll get to that. But a husband went to the store, took his daughter, little daughter, with him. And I don't know if you guys have ever done this with your children. I am guilty of doing this. He bought a bag of M&Ms for them. One of those good-sized bag of M&Ms, and he took it home, and his wife said, "Honey, you know these are not good for us. You know these are not good for you. Why did you get these bags, this bag of M&Ms?" And he said, "Well, honey, listen. This has one-third less calories." And she looked at the bag, and she says, "How do you figure this has one-third less calories?" And he said, "Because my daughter and I, whatever her name is, we ate one-third of them on the way home. So they have one-third less calories." How many of you have ever heard the saying, "The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak"? You've heard that, right? All right, we're going to talk about this today. We're going to talk about Jesus' temptation. Since the fall of Adam and Eve in the garden, temptation has been a constant, unrelenting part of life. Men have tried to avoid, resist, or ignore it, but no person has ever found a place or circumstance that can make him safe from temptation. And so in Matthew 4, one of the most monumental, mysterious, spiritual battles of all time, there's a personal confrontation between Jesus Christ and between Satan. Satan is not omniscient. He doesn't know all things. He is not omnipotent. He's not all-powerful. And he is not all-present. He can't be everywhere. God can. Okay? God can. You and I have never been tempted by Satan. You and I have been tempted by his demons. You and I have been tempted by our own flesh. Jesus was tempted by the devil. The devil's temptations have been observed by no other human being. Were directed at Jesus. He was entirely alone, and is therefore obvious that we could know nothing of what transpired there unless Jesus had told the disciples of it. So the encounter with Satan occurred immediately after Jesus' baptism, where the Father proclaimed out of heaven, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." When God speaks to you, Satan strikes at you. When God fills you, the devil fights you. Our text demonstrates why Jesus was well-pleasing to his Father. And so Jesus listened to his Father's word and applied his word to his daily life. The purpose of Matthew's recounting this event is to demonstrate the pattern of Jesus' victory over temptation and sin. It's a pattern that Jesus longs to share with all who belong to him. So let's look at this passage. I'm not going to make you stand. We're not going to take the time to read it. We'll just go through it verse by verse, and we'll read it that way. But we're going to see three parts: the preparation, the temptation, and the triumph. Look at chapter 4, verse 1. "Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, afterward, he was hungry." All right? The goal of all believers should be the same as Jesus. I want to please my Father. I want to please my Father. We all would love to hear that our life is pleasing to God. But that statement, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased," caused a showdown. There was a showdown in the desert between good and evil, between light and dark, between obedience and disobedience, between Jesus and Satan. And when we live for Jesus, it'll cause the same for us. Satan wants to tempt us, he wants to try us, and he wants to devour us. Jesus had the same testimony of Enoch in the Old Testament. That was, he pleased God, but his commitment is about to be tested. Look at verse 1 again. Jesus was led up by whom? The Spirit. He didn't go on his own. He was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. There was a purpose. There was a reason for him going there. One of the truths of life from which even the Son of God was not exempt on earth was this. And you might want to write this down. After victory comes temptation. After victory comes temptation. There have been times on Sunday mornings when things have gone great and wonderful and God has been pleased. People have come to know the Lord. We've seen great victory. We've seen people come to know Jesus. We've seen people praying over their sin and asking for confession for their sin. We've seen all of that. And Monday is the worst day in the world. It just happens. And you say, well, that's just a coincidence. It's not a coincidence. The devil does not like God to be praised. And so when you're praising God, you need to be aware and awake and understanding. And Jesus knew that. God's plan and purpose is Satan's temptations as a means of testing and strengthening faith in him. In verse 2, we read this understatement of Jesus' physical condition. Verse 2. When he had fasted, how long? 40 days and 40 nights. Afterward, he was hungry. What is the significance in this scripture of 40 days and 40 nights? Okay, it rained for 40 days and 40 nights. Anything else you can think of? Moses, what about Moses? Okay. It was 40 years. I was getting there. All right. Yeah. So we're going to see Jesus make three statements out of Scripture. These three statements come from the book of Deuteronomy. Most of the time when we get through and we're reading through the Bible, we get through Genesis and we get into Exodus. And then we get to Leviticus and we go, oh, right? And then we get to Numbers, we go, a bunch of numbers. And math people, nobody can get math right. Deutero means second. Onomy is law. So it is the second law. Well, I thought God only gave one law. Yeah, he did. Second law is a rehashing. It is Moses telling us what the children, telling the second generation of Israelites that are getting ready to go into the promised land, he's reminding them of how God delivered the people out of Egypt and how he delivered them, and he did all these things, and they were in the wilderness, and what their attitude was and all their actions. So Deuteronomy is all about the 40 years that it took to get out of the wilderness. And so here he's saying this: you were disobedient to God in those 40 years. That's why you had to wander around, because you were disobedient to God. Jesus is saying after 40 days and 40 nights of not eating or drinking, that after 40 days of fasting, that he is going to be obedient to the Father. And so he's going to show us how to do that. So here's the preparation. And I love how Matthew writes this. He had not eaten for 40 days and 40 nights. And what is his next phrase in there? He was hungry. Now look, some of you can't go 40 minutes without being hungry. Right? You know, I know teenagers, that's the truth with you guys. Look, Jesus, he says, became hungry. Do you think that maybe in those 40 days and 40 nights, he might not have had some times and moments where he thought maybe he was hungry? It hadn't come up on him? I believe that he was in such close communion going with his Father in those 40 days and 40 nights being led by the Spirit that he didn't realize. He didn't realize what was going on. He didn't realize he was hungry. He didn't need to be fed that way. He needed to be fed more with the Word of God. With the Word of God. And so Jesus tells us, because of these temptations, that we need to keep watching and praying that we may not come into temptation. Victory over temptation comes from a constant abiding in the Spirit and the Word of God. The word fasting is a form of self-discipline. It's a refraining from the good and necessary substance of this life in order to hear from God more clearly. It's setting aside the things, and we so many times think of fasting as setting aside food and water for a certain period of time. But it can mean setting aside other good things in our life that we're just going to focus on God and set those things aside as well. You might want to fast from your phones. That would be a good thing, right? You might want to fast from the TV. I think fasting from the news is a great thing right now. You might want to fast from, some of you want to fast from your children. But that may not be a good thing. Fasting is more than just eating. But Jesus here is more focused on just where Jesus is in the wilderness is on eating in this way. But Jesus was fasted in there, and afterwards it tells us that he was being tempted by the tempter. So at the end of 40 days, when Jesus would have been as hungry and tired as a person could be, the devil goes after him. That's how the devil is with us. He waits until we are tired and weary and discouraged, and then he comes after us. You come home from a hard day at work, and your wife looks at you, and she's not my wife, but she said it to me this morning. She said, "Pastor Kevin, I see you're a man. You just throw your socks on the floor." I won't mention her name because I don't want to embarrass Fred's wife. "Honey, I wish you wouldn't throw your clothes right on the floor." And you look at your wife and you say, "Hey, whatever happened to the word hello? Why are you hitting with me with this now? Don't you know I've worked all day? I'm tired. I'm hungry." She says, "Well, what do you think I've been doing? I'm tired. I'm hungry. I've worked all day too. I don't want to pick up your messy clothes, much less work at them." And just like that, two loving, kind Christian people have started World War III. They have broken out in the Rock'em Sock'em robots. The devil's strategy: hit the people of faith when they are tired and they are weary. That is what he did to Jesus. Now let's look at the temptation, verses 3 through 10. Satan came at Jesus in three different ways. Three temptations for three needs, overcome by three answers from him. Most people forget that it is not a sin to be tempted, but we sin when we yield to temptation. Temptations are merely opportunities to sin, but God always provides a way of escape so that we can handle any temptation that comes our way. And the first temptation was for Jesus to distrust the providential care of his Father and to serve himself. The second was to presume on the Father's care by putting his Father to the test. And the third was for him to renounce the way of his Father and to substitute the way of Satan. So temptation number one is self-satisfaction, or live to satisfy your needs and your desires. And so we're going to see a need, a challenge, and response in each one of these. The first need comes from verse 3. He says, "Now when the tempter came to him, he said, 'If you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread.'" Real physical need of hunger. He has this real physical need of hunger. That's what he used to tempt Jesus into succumbing to temptation to turn these stones into bread. Now, let's just be honest. Could Jesus have done that? Yes. Yes. Here's the challenge. Look again at that verse. If you are the Son of God. What was he doing? Satan wants to twist the divine mission of the Son of God. He's asking the question, Jesus, what kind of Messiah are you going to be? You can use your supernatural power for physical needs. If you turn rocks into bread, people will follow you. All you need to do is give them some food. Meet their legitimate physical human needs. It was a temptation for him to act independently of the Father, to act supernaturally, to meet his own needs instead of depending upon the Father to meet his needs. Would Jesus use his position? Would Jesus use his authority for selfish ends? Would Jesus use his power for selfish ends? The devil wanted to raise doubts in Jesus' mind. He wanted to see Jesus say, I haven't eaten for 40 days. Is God ever going to come through for me? Can I trust God? Is he going to be there for me when I need him? Am I going to have to act on my own, or will I follow God and depend on him to meet all my needs, no matter how pressing they are? That's the questions he was asking Jesus. That's the questions that Jesus is asking us. The devil often uses a legitimate need, but he tempts us by seeking to fulfill that need in an illegitimate way. Many people have doubts that God can provide for them financially, physically, spiritually. He can't meet your human needs is what many people believe. Satan seeks to exploit a weakness of hunger to cause Jesus to be impatient with the Father, rather than launch out in an independent, self-satisfying life. Jesus is going to trust the Father. He's going to be a great example for us in our time of need to trust the Father. Look at Jesus' response in verse 4. He answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Here's the challenge, or Jesus' response is to feed on the word. Feed on the word. And here, remember, we talked about him, those three statements coming from the book of Deuteronomy. This is from Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. Feed on the word. The word of God is sufficient to sustain you. The word of God is sufficient to sanctify to you, to set you apart, to support you in your most desperate hour of being tempted. Jesus insisted that people need more in their life than just bread. We need the word of God. Amen. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of your wife, of your husband, of the radio preacher, from the mouth of God, from the mouth of God. Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. The psalmist wrote, how can a young man keep his way pure? By keeping it according to your word. Your word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. So what is Jesus telling us here? We need to know the word of God. We need to memorize the word of God. And we need to keep it. It'll keep it in our hearts because it'll keep us from sin. The word of God will keep us from destroying ourselves. The word of God will keep us from disobedience. the Word of God will keep us from what the enemy is doing today. He is deceiving many, many people. So focus on God's eternal purpose and not your own temporary concerns as you face tests in your life. True life depends not upon satisfying material wants, but upon obedience to following God. For Jesus to turn stones into bread would have been to place personal physical need ahead of his need to obey and trust his Father. God calls us to reordering our priorities that places confidence in him as our highest good. So number one is self-satisfaction. That's what the devil tempted Jesus to do. Number two is self-accomplishment. Self-accomplishment. His next strategy, get Jesus to focus on himself instead of upon God. He wants Jesus to rationalize, compromise, attempt to complete God's purpose in the wrong way. Look at verse 5. The devil took him up into a holy city, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and he said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down. For it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone." What is the need here? The need is public praise. Jesus, throw yourself down. And guess what? Everybody down in the temple area will look at you. Look at what you've done. Look at how great you are. When my kids were younger, they played rec league basketball. One of the best and worst things in the world. It's great for the kids. Parents are terrible. And I had this one boy on my team, Brandon's team, and I was coaching. I was assistant coach then. And he was a fourth grader. And they played fourth, fifth, and sixth grade in Brandon's league. And so they were playing ball. And he made like four shots in a row. And it came halftime. And we went out in the cafeteria of the school and sat down and talked to the boys. And he was like, "Did you see this shot I made? I shot that over there, that three I hit in the corner. I'm only in fourth grade. Look at me making all these shots. Look at me. I hit that shot, and then I turned around and hit another shot. And I did this, and I did that." And I looked at him, and I said, "You know what? You are not Michael Jordan. You are not even LeBron James. You are a fourth grade boy. Get your head out of the clouds, because guess what? You've missed more shots than you've made." Now, I picked him back up after that, but I wanted him to understand, it's not about you. It's not about you. And the devil's trying to get Jesus to think about, it's you. It's you, Jesus. It's you. And he takes a beautiful verse about trusting God, and he twists it into an invitation to tempt God. And you say that not turning the stones into bread, Jesus, that you are trusting God. Now publicly demonstrate that trust in God by throwing yourself down and let people see all the angels come and rescue you. Satan takes this verse out of context. It's in Psalm 91, 11, and 12. He omits part of it to guard you in all your ways and then twist it to get it to say something God never intended. And that's what that Satan does with Scripture. God has promised his providential care for our life as we daily live it out in a normal fashion. He has not promised to supernaturally intervene when we decide to step outside of his will and jeopardize our life in order to force him into action. And the challenge here is throw yourself down. Let the people see the angels come after you. Let the angels take care of you. There were many people there at that time. And Jesus could have immediately become a popular figure right then and there. But that was not God's will for his life. That was not God's purpose in sending Jesus. Sensationalism appeals to the flesh. And Jesus wants our hearts. It was God's will that he take on the nature of a servant. In Mark, Jesus tells us, I have come to serve and not be served. And many of the battles that we find ourselves are over the same thing. Satan will come, and he'll try to get us to take the focus off of God and to put it on ourselves. Our own need, our own wants, to satisfy our own hearts. And he'll try to cause the word, the will, or the way of God to become fuzzy and unclear so that we get sidetracked. He will offer you an alternative to God's will, an alternative to God's way, an alternative to God's word. And he will try to get you to think that you're still following God. So the second temptation is about the plan that God has for you. God has a purpose, a plan for your life. He has designed you, and he's trying to mold you into his eternal purposes. So when following his word, will, and way, your life will be lived for your eternal best. When God called Abraham to trust him, to wait for the promised one, he did, until he didn't. And one day, God had promised that he would have be a father, he would have a child through his wife Sarah, but one day, rational thinking that he was, heard and listened to his wife. And he went into her handmaid and had a child with her. His name was Ishmael. Men, you should really listen to your wives. Abraham should not have listened to his wife. God said to wait, but there seemed to be a better, a quicker way to accomplish God's plan. After all, God, Abraham and Sarah are old, and you need our help. Isn't that what we think? What a huge mistake that was. And we're seeing some of that play out even today. There is suffering to this day for that rationale. Once again, in verse 7, Jesus turns the Old Testament scripture for a wise response. Verse 7, Jesus said, "It is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." Don't tempt God. That's his response. Don't tempt God. It comes from Deuteronomy 6, verse 6, where it refers to the time when Moses struck the rock in order to get water to satisfying the grumbling Israelites. Because God did not immediately meet their expectations, they questioned Moses' leadership, God's faithfulness. And faith is simply trusting God, taking him at his word, no matter our circumstances or our trials. We are not to try and force God's hand, but simply to take God's hand and follow him. Jesus quoted scripture. But it wasn't his ability to quote scripture that gave him the victory. He quoted scripture to let Satan know that he was committed to trusting his Father. He was committed to trusting God. He was committed to obeying the Word of God. There are many people who know the Word of God. There are many people who can quote the Word of God. They can shout it from the rooftop. I had a friend who was a PK. You know what a PK is, right? A pastor's kid. Yeah, I grew up with him. And we hung out together for a long time. And then my mom said I couldn't hang out with him anymore. I don't know why. Just because he was getting in trouble with the police didn't mean anything. He could quote scripture. Man, he could argue scripture with you. He could quote it. But he didn't obey it. He didn't obey it. You cannot go around compromising the word and expect to walk and victory over temptation. It is our commitment to obey the Word of God and to expect to walk in victory over temptation. So we have self-satisfaction, self-accomplishment, and then the third temptation from 8 and 9 is self-glorification. I keep looking at a clock and it hasn't moved a minute, so we're good. Verse 8, again, the devil took him up on an exceeding high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. He said to them, all these things I give you if you will fall down and do what? Worship me. Jesus was given this great vision of all the kingdoms of the world. Satan displayed all of his earthly kingdoms. And he said, these all can be yours. Jesus would later call Satan the ruler of this world. John stated that the entire world is under the power of the evil one. So apparently, Satan had the right to give them to Jesus. God also promised Jesus a kingdom. But these kingdoms that Satan was offering would not require the shame and the suffering of the cross. So Jesus is faced with this age-old temptation that the end justifies the means. The way of obedience is long, hard, and difficult. Why not make a deal with the prince of this world? Why not compromise to obtain the desired end, the kingdom, immediately? Use the arsenal of diabolical, political, and worldly weapons to seize the prize of sovereignty without the delay or suffering that God Himself has promised you. The price of immediate possession was simply bowing the knee and worshiping Satan. Instead of enduring the long, bitter, humiliating, painful road to the cross and the even longer wait in heaven for God's time to be completed, Jesus, you worship me, you can rule the world right now. Satan suggests the world of business, politics, fame, or of whatever our hearts desire. It can be yours. If only you can get what you want. Every desire fulfilled. Every fantasy fulfilled. You can be somebody. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of hearing about Taylor Swift. If she had never started dating that famous football player, she would be nobody. All we have to do to get everything we want is worship the devil. He tempts us. And he says, why are you setting your standards so high? What is the use? You can get what you want by cutting a corner here, by shading the truth there. Why wait for heavenly reward when you can have what you want right now? When we set our hearts on money or prestige or popularity or power or selfish happiness, we are doing exactly what Satan wants us to do. Put yourself first. Have you thought about this? Had Jesus fallen for Satan's trick, his temptation, the statement when he was on the cross where they mocked him and said, he saved others, let him save himself, would have been reversed. It would have said, he saved himself, others he cannot save. Instead of redeeming the world, he would have joined the world. Instead of paying the price for you and I, he would have been dying for himself. And Jesus' response is very clear, straightforward. Look at verse 10. Jesus said, get out of here, Satan. Away with you. For it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve. Deuteronomy 6:13. God's word is the final argument, ultimate authority against our enemy. Jesus proclaimed in no uncertain terms, he would not compromise with evil. Why should we? His advice to you and I would be just don't do it. He advocated a focus on who God was. Listen, many people are more interested in the blessing than they are the blesser. If you find yourself this Thanksgiving giving thanks for things, instead of the first thing out of your mouth being, thank you, God, that you are God, and I am not, your focus may be in the wrong place. And Jesus looked at him, and this is the advice I give to you, and the advice Jesus gave to each and every one of us is when we are tempted, we ought to be saying the same thing Jesus said, worship the Lord your God, and him only shall we serve. Amen? Amen. He alone can satisfy. He alone can satisfy your soul. He alone can fill your soul, the hunger that you have in your soul. Those who seek the Lord shall not want in anything. Listen, how many of you would open up your doors and let in a 12-foot Burmese python? Figures, you don't have a brain. You're a teenager. Your brain is not formed right. Right? Why would you do that? And yet people, and there was a couple in Florida, took home a python, a Burmese python, put it in a glass aquarium, and felt like we are safe. We're okay. And a horrible event took place one night when that 12-foot python got out of its cage and did what a 12-foot python does. He found their 2-year-old daughter. We wouldn't open up the doors to our home and let something evil like that in. But we'll open up the doors of our hearts and let evil come in. That old serpent, the snake, works tirelessly. Bible tells us he is roaming to and fro looking for someone to devour. I told you this last week. I wish he'd go on vacation, but he never does. He wants you to believe that your house is not in danger. And you feel like, oh, it's okay, I know how to restrain him. And I'm telling you, the scripture says, give no place to the devil. He is a snake. And a snake is always a snake. One time we were having an event here. I'll tell you this real quick because we got to go. We were having an event downstairs for our children, and we had the door open. And some of you might remember this, but I was outside with RJ, and we were sitting standing over by the fire talking and everything. My wife came inside with some of the kids, and Matthew Maynard goes, hey, there's a snake. And I hear this piercing scream, and I looked at RJ and said, she found a snake. So how do I know? I've heard that scream before. I came running in. We came running in here, and RJ picked it up as a little gardener, like the big, little tiny thing. A snake is. And you know what Matthew said? He said, it's a good snake. You know what my wife said? There's no such thing as a good snake. Listen real quick, verse 11, the triumph. Look at, the devil left him. The devil left him. But not for long. But angels came and ministered to him. That snake had no choice but to leave him because he had been obedient to the Father. Real quick, turn to Matthew chapter 7. Just real quick. I know some of you already put your Bibles away. Ha, gotcha. There are many good things that God will give us in this life. No one desires our joyfulness, not our happiness, our joyfulness more than our Heavenly Father. Matthew chapter 7, verse 7 says, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. Oh, what man is there among you who, if his son asks for a bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? Corey, for Christmas, are you going to give your child, your children, coal and bad things, or are you going to give them good things? Depends. Are they good? Right? Most fathers are going to say, I'm going to give them good things. Why? Because that's who we are. Don't you think your Father in heaven knows what you need and knows what he's going to give you? Listen, the reason this lesson is in the Bible is it's very simple. Obedience, obedience, obedience. The Word of God is the authority for right living. Since Jesus had mastered the Bible, he could not be mastered by anything, by anyone, including the devil himself. So when the devil does attack us, or we feel like he's attacking us, or it's a demon when he comes against us, or our families, or our business, or our finances, or our church, or even our health, how are we going to respond? How do we actually stand up and fight, face up against the devil? Are we going to try and satisfy ourselves, achieve accomplishment? Are we going to glorify ourselves instead of the Father? He seems so intimidating, but it's always important to keep in mind that he's like a dog on a leash. And it's also important to keep in mind what we talked about at the end of last week about the movie called The Bear, that the lion is out there roaring. And we may stand up to him and think we're fighting him and being against him. But there's someone behind us who's got our back. And it's our Father. And guess what? The devil has never defeated our Father. And he never will. And he never will. Father, thank you for the fact that you have given us this promise that he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world, and that we can trust you and we can lean on you. And Father, I thank you for your goodness and your grace. Lord, bless this time as the children come up, and we thank you for them. And we just thank you for the ability to be able to give back a part of what you've given to us, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, all right, sit back and relax and enjoy the show. Grab Kleenexes, give them to Fred.
Hear the sound
This is one of my favorite times when the kids bring these gifts in. Just reminds me of the blessing and what where these are going to children whose hearts are open to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Corey, I agree with you now. Cole. And so these, do we know where these will be going yet? Do we have any idea? So they'll be going somewhere, right? So how many do we have total? Okay. Over 1,000. Praise God. Amen. So as we do all the time, let's go ahead and gather around these boxes. We're going to pray over them as God prepares to move in the hearts of the people that will receive them, the children, not only the children, but their parents. And we'll also pray for Bill. Yes. Gather around, put your hand on a box. You can't reach them. I will hand you one. You can go up on top too. Some of you young guys.
Just put your hand on one, Leon. Good job, buddy.
That's a good one.
That's a good one.
That's a girl.
It's a girl.
That's a boy.
That's a boy. That's a boy right there.
All right, let's pray together. Again, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, you have worked in hearts today. And I just pray, Father, that the Spirit would continue to work in our hearts and remind us of your presence and your love and your goodness. Father, we do, especially today, right now, want to lift up Bill to you. Father, we pray for those that are working on him, that you'll give them wisdom, Father, and just encourage them, and encourage him as well. We pray for complete healing. Lord, we thank you for your love. We pray, Father, for these boxes. You've helped us to pack, put together, and Lord, they'll be sent out this week. And we pray, Father, that as they go from here to Charlotte or wherever the sending city is that they're going, that you bless the hands that would touch them. And then, Father, I pray that as they go from there to the countries they're going to, that wherever they go, Lord, that you would open that child's heart and their family's heart to the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, which changes lives. And Lord, we thank you for this. Thank you for loving us. And I just pray that you would continue to use this little church to reach out into the world through boxes, through prayer, and through the uplifting of the Spirit to others, Lord. Not just around the world, but also in our Jerusalem and our Judea here in West Virginia. That we would be your lighthouse, sharing the good news of Jesus. And we thank you for that. Thank you for your love, and thank you for all that you're going to do in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. There is small groups tonight. My small group will be working. I just want to say happy birthday to Robert. And men's Bible study Monday. Oh, listen, we still need about $2,000 to pay for these, to ship them out. So if you can help us, Virgie has a box. Put some money in it and help us out. We appreciate it. Thank you.
It's
your dad's birthday, too. Happy birthday to Mr. John Maynard.